He graduated from West Point in 2008. He finished last year in Afghanistan in the Striker Platoon. And while he was there, while he was home for his leave, we sort of arranged for some packages to be sent. How many did we send, Phil? 20 or 30 packages?
That's right, he'll talk about
that. Yeah, anyway, he's going to talk about that. And I think one of his slides will show that. Worked out extremely well. Anyway, Rajiv is now doing recruiting duty down in New York City. He's also a PhD student at King's College in London, and a nice young man, nice, very young man. Without further ado, Rajiv Srinivasan.
I want to thank you all for having me here today. We do have the best, biggest, baddest, strongest army in the world, and that did not happen overnight. And it's because of the commitment and a lifelong servitude that is here in this room and around the country from generations of soldiers and soldiers' families that we have that strong military. So I want to thank you for everything you guys do to keep this community going and keep soldiers like me well-informed and feeling like I'm fighting for something bigger than myself. So I want to thank you for that. Yeah, absolutely. Give yourselves a round of applause. Absolutely. As Bill mentioned, there was a pretty huge group of people here that supported me and my soldiers when I was in Afghanistan. I received almost 60 boxes from the Boston Red Sox Foundation. Is that correct, Phil?
Yeah.
For my soldiers. I'm sorry?
And from here.
And from the Lexington Vets Group. I tell you what, the best feeling of the world is my fellow platoon leader, a diehard Yankees fan. I went up to his room and I dropped that Boston Red Sox box on his cot and his hooch, and I asked, yeah, you know, Yankees may win World Series, but at least Boston loves America. And I tell you what, there's nothing like watching a bunch of soldiers, you know, they're in the dirt, they haven't showered in weeks, and they're working hard, they're in a very, very dangerous area, but when they popped on that baseball cap, you know, something that's familiar to home, a smile came across their face like you wouldn't believe. So I want to thank you all very much for supporting my men when they were overseas. That really means a lot to me. So I'm here today to talk to you about Afghanistan and the challenges that platoon leaders are facing. And the reason why, can everybody see the map up there right now? The reason why this is important is because this is a platoon leaders and squad leaders fight. It's not, you know, battalion level operations going on every day. It's not brigade level operations or even company level operations that are happening on a day-to-day level. On a day-to-day level, it is platoons that are out there patrolling, fighting, interacting with those local tribal elders, and rebuilding this country. And they are the grip on the boots of this counterinsurgency. And unfortunately, in the United States Army, as everyone knows, is when you are a lieutenant on the ground, you can't spell lost without LT, right? And so a very few bits of those critical pieces of information, I feel, make it up to the policy and senior level decision-making processes. It leaves a lot of our constituency uninformed. So this is something that really means a lot to me, is sharing the story from the ground level. What are platoon leaders doing? What does the ground look like from the get-go? So with that, we'll go ahead and get started. If you have any questions, feel free to ask them. I'm a very informal speaker, so we'll get started here. So what I have for you here right now is a map of Afghanistan. A few things that I want you to keep in mind is, first, the tremendous number of borders, international borders that we're talking about, not only Pakistan, but Iran, Turkmenistan, Uzbekistan, Tajikistan, China, anything with a stan on the end seems to touch Afghanistan. Now, the reason why this is significant is because we are looking at borders that are Western imposed. and they are Western imposed from British colonial era periods, particularly Sykes-Picot 1916, the Egyptian or British General Condominium Agreements, Balfour in 1941. To make a long story short, basically how I describe it is a giant oval was drawn in the Hindu Kush, and they called it Afghanistan. Within these borders are Hazaras, there's Tajiks, there's Turks, there's Pashtuns, there's Persians, there's a wide smorgasbord of ethnic groups, of religions, of languages. This is a country who it's not a nation state by any means. It is not homogeneous, and it is very difficult to take so many different varieties of people, varieties of lifestyle, varieties of tribal affiliations, and somehow build a national identity. That is a struggle we face on the ground level. Now, during my tour, I served in the province of Kandahar. It's in southwest Afghanistan. Everyone can see it if I go back to the map as this dot in the south. It shares a border with Pakistan, and it's divided up into these districts. Now, Kandahar is interesting in that it is technically the birthplace of the Taliban. Mullah Muhammad Omar was born there, very close into the district where I served, which is Zari Panjway. Panjway is that big giant green blob you see on the western side. You also have through this province a section of Highway 1. Highway 1 is what is a subset of what is called Ring Road. Basically, it was a USAID project that is the one hardball path that spans the country from, let's go back up to the map here, all the way north. It starts in Mazar-e Sharif up at the very top of the key, goes all the way to Herat, all the way down to through Helmand and Kandahar, up through Ghazni, and eventually going up to Kabul and back again. It's a giant circle. It's the one hardball that spans the entire country. And that hardball road goes across this district. Now, that's significant in that it is a main highway avenue approach from population centers and a lot of the poppy trade, which goes on in both Kandahar and Helmand. So these are some factors that I'd like you to keep in mind as we go through the storyline here. I'm not a big PowerPoint guy. I don't like bullets, but I love pictures, and a picture tells 1,000 words. So I'm not gonna bullet point you to death on PowerPoint. I'm gonna show you some pictures, and we'll talk about what it's like from a visual standpoint for our guys on the ground. This is my platform. This is called an MGS vehicle, a mobile gun system. It is a variant of what is called a striker. Now, a striker is interesting in that it is 8 wheels. It's an 8-wheeled infantry carrier variant. Its default variant is an infantry carrier variant. It has what you call, first off, slat armor on the sides, which is devised to disable an RPG round when it's shot at you. It is fast. This thing can fly. I mean, on record, I'm sure max speed's around 65. I mean, we were on downhill. I mean, you can push this thing really, really fast. Now, this is great when you're on a hardball road and you're trying to catch some bad guys who are trying to escape after doing something bad and you want to chase them down. When this 28-ton vehicle comes flying at you at 70 miles an hour, let me tell you, you pull over. So this variant is very interesting in that for any tankers in the audience, I'm also a tank officer, I'm an armor officer, which is the best branch in the Army, let me tell you. But that is a 105mm main gun. It sits on a turret that it's pretty powerful. Now everybody knows the Abrams tank is 120mm, it's a little bit smaller. But for the purposes of a counterinsurgency, when we're looking at a more population-centric fight, the collateral damage of our rounds we need to keep a good control of. This was actually a very good weapon system for us. We did a lot of good things with this and protected the boys. So this is what a striker looks like. This is my viewpoint from my hatch, in my commander's hatch, in my infantry carrier vehicle. The reason why I show you this is look at how much dead space is in front of me. And this is the front of the vehicle. Behind me is almost 3 times as much dead space. To my sides, I can barely see anything that's around me. The reason why this is important is when we are trying to work in a population-centric fight, and I need to interact and control population, people, kids, wives, children, whoever's running around, I don't really have a good view of what's going on in my immediate surroundings. Now that's, you know, a trade-off. We trade that off because this vehicle is rather good in terms of protection. But in terms of the counterinsurgency fight, when we're in a dangerous area like Zari, Argandab, in Kandahar province, our immediate situational awareness is inherently minimized because of this vehicle. And so this is one of the challenges that platoon leaders face, is that, yeah, you know, you can see, you know, 2, 3, 4, 5, 10 kilometers out, but when it comes to just 10 meters right outside your vehicle, You don't always know what's going on. And this is where the situational awareness from your soldiers, who are also on the platform, is very, very valuable. This is the Afghan National Army. This is the platoon that we mentored when I was in Afghanistan. Now, I'd like to bring up, the way I'm going to devise my talk here is through the various missions, besides just the kinetic fight that our soldiers are fighting. The first one I'm going to talk about is training the local indigenous population, training the Afghan National Army. These soldiers, let me tell you, they are warriors. They are certainly warriors, but they are not soldiers. I hope you all can understand what I mean by that. They are warriors. They have the heart. They have the fight. This is a country that's been occupied and abandoned for generations on end, whether it's the Americans, the Soviets, the British, the Mongols, the Persians, the Greeks. These folks know how to fight, but it's controlling that fight, controlling their instincts, and having them learn how to work as a team that becomes the biggest challenge. The first thing I'll point out is that you can't really see it in this picture, but their weapon systems are another smorgasbord of weapon systems. Some had M16s, some had AK-47s, a few would have some PRKs or some other sort of machine gun, but there was very little uniformity amongst them. Their uniforms are, you know, secondhand. Their vehicles are secondhand. They're not working with a bunch of technology. Nothing certainly like what we American soldiers are running around with. They speak a variety of language. While the national language of the Army is Dari, there is a lot of Pashtun being spoken. Now, another issue that these folks face in the ANA, and this is an interesting dichotomy between the ANA and what's the ANP. The ANA, by mission, is supposed to protect the country. The ANP is supposed to protect the people. Now, the ANA recruit nationally. So the vast majority of these soldiers are not from Kandahar, even though they are serving in Kandahar. Many of them are from Badakhshan, Bamiyan, Mazar-i-Sharif, a lot from Kabul, a lot from Ghazni. But very few, in fact, are from Kandahar alone. Now, this works for us in some ways because there's fewer local loyalties. They're less likely to have some local ties, some corrupt ties, and less likely to take a kickback if they're allowing some bad behavior to continue on. But that being said, they also are a little bit more apathetic towards the local population. Now, let me ask you this. We have some pretty severely tight rules of engagements put on our soldiers in Afghanistan. But I ask you this. If you're a family member just walking in your, you know, poppy field one day and a giant RPG land next to you, do you really care if it's fired by an American? Or does it matter? Because that RPG could have been fired by an Afghan from the Afghan National Army. And if you're a soldier from the Afghan National Army and you're not from this area, you're not from Kandahar, you're from Bamiyan, you don't really care too much about Kandaharis. You don't really care about this area. It's the redneck town of Afghanistan. You don't really care. You just shoot whatever you want. Whenever you feel threatened, you just shoot it, right? So the end result is, even though we have a restrictive ROE as Americans, when we would go on patrol with these folks, if they didn't have good discipline in when and how they fired their weapon systems, I mean, our rules of engagement didn't matter. You know, civilian casualties would be incurred. And unfortunately, whether it's fired by one of these folks or one of my soldiers, it still carries the coalition name. And that the repercussions of such restrictions don't, in the end of the day, didn't really help us that much in terms of winning local support. So these are some of the struggles we face. The other thing that I'd like to bring to the attention is that these guys smoke. And I'm not talking cigarettes, ladies and gentlemen. I am talking some marijuana, hashish. I mean, they love to have a good time. And it's cultural. It's cultural. It's something that we're not really accustomed to in the United States, just common proliferation of drugs everywhere we go, but it is in the Afghan army. Drug use was pretty prolific. And when you leave the wire and you're not in your best state of mind and you hear a little pop shot, you don't know what to do. Those soldiers are scared and they've retaliated in such a manner as you can expect. So what I'm trying to tell you here is that, again, they are warriors, but they're not soldiers. And this was one of the biggest challenges we faced. This was the outpost we lived in. As you can see, it's flooded. This was actually the first day I moved into town, and this town is Zari, Kandahar. It's flooded, very poor drainage system. They had a few HESCO barriers, about two towers, and most of this are built by Canadians, actually. The Canadians were here for a while, But no Americans had ever been in this part of the country at this point. So we had our work cut out for us. Excuse me. So like I said, one of our first issues was patrolling with the Afghan National Army and teaching them what it's like to be a conventional fighting force. Now the first and primary obstacle that we faced was the Afghan National Army unit that we were serving with. And keep in mind, the Afghan National Army doesn't cycle out soldiers like the United States Army does. The United States Army, you serve 3 years in one post, before you know it, boom, you're off to Fort Riley, and then 3 years later you're off to Fort Lewis, you're off to Fort Hood. We rotate, and what the effect of that is we have a mixing of institutional culture, and we mix up leadership, we mix up leadership styles, and the end result is that we have a more consistent expectation of what a unit's going to operate like. In the Afghan National Army, they don't have that. Most soldiers, most officers serve their entire careers in the same unit. And so if you have a unit with bad leadership, it tends to fester. And that was the situation in the 6th Kandak, which is who I served with. So one of the problems that these folks had is that they did the exact same patrol at the same time in the same place every day of the week. Now, I'm not sure what it was like in your generation, but I'm pretty sure it's the same as in mine, is that the minute you start setting patterns, you're making yourself and your soldiers vulnerable to attack. Am I right? Absolutely. And that's exactly what we found here. What this is the same checkpoint that this Afghan National Army unit established every day at the same time, the same place, and like clockwork, towards the middle of the tour, we could predict within an hour to 2 hours of a window when these folks would get attacked with RPGs, small arms fire, you name it. And so I made it my mission, unsuccessfully so, and I'm sorry to say that, to try and convince that company commander, hey, listen, change it up just a little. Even if you change the avenue of approach you take, even if you change the time, you know, delay it an hour, start a little hour earlier or something like that, do something different. Start getting out of these patterns. I mean, unfortunately, I wasn't able to convince them. And that's one of the hardest things that it is that we're fighting with some officers that don't really leave the wire. And the battalion commander that we were working with, and even the company commander, very rarely left the wire with their soldiers, unlike in the American Army. And this is the squad leader right now that's shaking my hand. He is the highest ranking guy on the ground at this time, and was for pretty much every time that I went to this checkpoint. So trying to get that chain of command to empathize with what these guys are going through every day. These are good people. These guys have families, they have kids, they're smart. And trying to get their chain of command to empathize with that was very difficult. This is the way we operated with them. After a while, when I would go on patrol with them, I made sure to array my vehicles to their flanks and to their rears to sort of cover them while they, you know, went through with their patrol, no matter how dangerous it was. Now, when my vehicles would come with them, they'd have a higher likelihood of not getting attacked. And the reason why is because, hey, that thing looks intimidating, doesn't it? I mean, that's a 28-ton cannon on top of a monster-looking Striker, you know? I'm sorry, not a 28-ton cannon, a 28-ton vehicle with a giant 105-millimeter gun. I mean, that's intimidating. So we were able to kind of stave off some attacks when we would roll with them, alongside them. And I made it a point to get on the ground, as you can see in the bottom right-hand corner, get on the ground with that senior Afghan on the ground and coordinate with him. But keep in mind, we don't have radio comms with these guys. They can't hear us, we can't hear them. Once we're in those vehicles, if they decide to go off in a totally different direction, how are you going to stop them? And that's an obstacle we face. At what point do we let them, how do we communicate with them electronically, digitally, so that we can coordinate when we're on mounted maneuver? It's one of the hardest obstacles of training these guys is when you leave the wire, our ComSec, our communication security, is such that we don't share it with the Afghans. And rightfully so. There's not a lot of trustworthy folks in this organization just yet. But that being said, we have no solution that we can securely talk to these folks and coordinate maneuver with them in our vehicles when we're outside the wire. And this was very, very difficult for us. The other issue that we found on the ground was because of those security concerns at mid-level and senior levels of command, there was decreasing levels of coordination with our local counterparts. So this is the scene of one of the largest Taliban captures in Kandahar at this time. This is in the Argandab River Valley. And I remember sitting on an outpost, and all of a sudden I have about 15 ANP, Afghan National Police vehicles, zooming by my position, and I'm thinking, oh my God, we're going to get hit. something bad is going down. These guys know it. So I take one of my vehicles and I go over and I say, hey, what's going on, guys? And the local AMP master sergeant says, hey, we just had a really big Taliban capture. We captured like 12 guys. And I was like, oh, that's awesome. Let's go. Can I see them? Can I get some pictures? Can I check them out? Confer with them so I can go tell my chain of command that, hey, everything's okay? He said, sure. So we went in, we saw them, took some pictures. Sure enough, there were a bunch of guys lying down. And it was unbelievable. That was my first time actually seeing the enemy up close. This is very early on in the tour. I went back out and I called my chain of command on the radio and I said, hey, this is what we saw, this is what we found. And long story short, no one at any level at which I had direct communication with had any idea that this was going on. This was done completely without the awareness of anyone in our chain of command. And we were operating in that AO for quite a while. And so that was very disconcerting to me, because it taught me that, like, if these guys are running around doing some pretty intense operations and making some, you know, pretty sleek nabs without us knowing, I mean, who knows? What if there were Americans in the area? What if it was us in the area and bullets started flying and somebody could have gotten hurt? So that was a little confusing. And, you know, obviously this is just a platoon leader's perspective. You know, maybe there was a little coordination going on up and they just didn't push that info down. I have to admit, you know, I have to be humble enough to admit that there are things that I don't know for a reason. But that was one of the most disconcerting moments of the tour. And what you see now is we are shaking hands with that guy in the center as the chief of Kandahar security for the province. He's a colonel. And we were the only Americans. I was the highest ranking at second lieutenant. I was the highest ranking guy on the ground at one of the largest Taliban captures in that town and scene. Go me. One of the most important parts of training in Afghan National Army is integrating my soldiers with theirs. A lot of outposts right now are situated such that the Americans and the Afghans have completely separate facilities the entire time they're there. They eat separately, they sleep separately, they train separately. The only time when most of these guys get together is like, you know, the day before a joint mission. They'll go, they'll confer, they'll go back their separate ways, and they'll meet again right before SP. Now, the reason why that's a problem is because about 90% of the battle is won before you even leave the wire. It's preparation, it's training, it's discipline. Are they getting enough sleep? Are they getting enough to eat? Are they training well? Are they smoking hashish before the mission? You know, there's so many parts of our culture that are very important to the United States Army that take place before you even leave the wire. Maintenance on the vehicles, maintenance on the weapons. And one thing that I tried to make sure that we do was integrate very well. So every now and then I would take my soldiers and just mosey on over to the Afghan National Army barracks, which was in this case a bunker, cement bunker. As you can see, it's not really the highest quality. It's not exactly the Hilton. We would sit around, we'd joke, they would offer us their tea, their hospitality was incredible. And you can see we had an interpreter there to help us communicate a little bit with them. And you know, soldiers are soldiers. Soldiers in any country are just like soldiers in every other country. We're all kids. We all like to smoke and joke and have a good time, make fun of each other, kid around. We're young guys. And it was cool for my soldiers to finally see with their own eyes that, hey, you know what? Yeah, these guys don't speak the same language. For many of them, these were the first foreigners that they'd ever really interacted with. And, you know, they don't speak the same language. They don't look like us. And they don't act like us. But at the end of the day, we're all the same. And that was a cool realization I think a lot of my soldiers came away with after we started doing some events like these. Okay, now I'm gonna transition away from training the Afghan National Army and talk about working with contractors. One of my jobs, and honestly the most important part of my role in this in the war, was a contracting officer. Now this is typically a job that's given as kind of like, oh, just give it to that LT, no one wants to deal. I'm a warrior, I'm a soldier, I just wanna shoot. All I wanna do is shoot stuff. But no, you know, I took that mission, I took it seriously, because when you're the contracting officer, I was given basically throughout the course of a year a cumulative like $1 million to build a combat outpost in the middle of one of the most dangerous deserts and figure it out, you know, when we're taking fire. And you know, you can't just wait for your higher echelon to hand down resources for you all the time. Sometimes you just have to dig in and make it happen yourself. And that was the great thing about being the guy who with the money, is if I needed something to happen, money talks. And I could make it happen. So this is one of these situations where I needed to dig in some holes. I'm sorry, fill in some holes. So everybody know what a HESCO barrier is? Okay, a HESCO barrier is a 7-foot by 7-foot giant cloth and wire wrapping that holds dirt. The reason why is it takes about, I think it's something like 5 or 6 inches of solid dirt to stop a 7.62 round, or there's some calculation there that how they develop how deep and how tall to make these HESCO barriers. And so these HESCO barriers are just dirt barriers that are you're able to build outposts with. Now the dirt, it doesn't like come with the package or something like that. They give you the HESCO barriers and you have to fill it up with the dirt that you have on site. Now the issue is that these Afghans had filled in their HESCO barriers with dirt from within their COP. So now we had just giant holes in the middle of our COP, and we're like, what are we gonna do with all these holes? They were holding water and it just became very frustrating. So I needed to fill those in so we could put some gravel on top of it and eventually build what would then be our barracks or containers. And I go up to the only person I know at this time. I'd never said, it's my first day on foot, and I say, hey, sir, and I'm talking to this guy in the top of the screen. He's an Afghan National Army officer, he's the S2. He's a Captain Nasrallah. And I say, hey, I need to fill in some dirt. I want a grader, I'm gonna get a front end loader, and I wanna get some gravel. Who can help me out? And he says, yeah, don't worry, I'll help you out. I'll go to this guy. So he takes me to this guy, right? This guy at the bottom of the screen. And he says, yeah, sure, no problem, Lieutenant Srinivasan. Let's see, let me do the math here. What is that, about half a football field? $40,000. Does anybody do the math on this? $40,000? Now, the thing that I learned very quickly is when you wear that United States Army name tag, you are the richest guy in town, no matter who you are. Yeah, me and my second lieutenant's salary, you know, he said, this guy's a rich kid. I'm going to take him for all he's worth. No, but seriously, they imagine that, you know, if I'm on the front line of a contracting operation, they assume that I have a bank's load of money that I'm hauling in my rucksack. And that certainly wasn't the case. So I was like, what am I going to do here? I don't know anybody. How am I going to get this done? Well, it turns out that this guy was an MOD contractor, and he'd already had a contract on post. So you know what I did? I went to this little guy, this Popeye-looking figure, and he was just shoveling away, you know, digging a hole. And I was like, hey, let me go ask this guy what's up. So I say, hey, sir, I'm Rajiv Srinivasan. I'm a lieutenant here. I just need to get a front-end loader, a grader, and some gravel. You know anybody in this area who can help me out? And you know, Popeye just shakes his head. He's so sweet, so kind. He's like, yeah, let me see what I can do. I paid him like the equivalent of maybe $1,000 or so. And before I knew it, I had a grader, a front-end loader, ready to go. These guys were unstoppable. Now, here's the problem though. When he came to help me out, the Afghan National Army guys who ran this post wouldn't let him in. And so I had to kind of get some work started ahead. We weren't just gonna sit around and wait. And you know, these are some of the Afghan National Army officers that I was working with to get this thing done. And you know, I tried my best to win their hearts and minds. You know, I tried to give them, I gave him a whole truckload of water because his pump wasn't working one day. And you know, I just said, hey, I'll help him out. Come on, give me some help here. And they just would not let my contractors on post. And this became a pretty significant issue for the vast majority of my time in combat, is a lack of cooperation with those senior leaders who were controlling the gates of that COP. Because whether we liked it or not, even though we thought we owned that place, the Afghans own the place. Like, let's be honest here, it's their country, they know the locals, they know who is dangerous, who's good, who's bad, who's got the money, who's got the power. We got the guns, but one thing I learned very quickly is that doesn't mean very much. Just because you got the guns doesn't mean you control the area. So when we didn't have, let me tell you something, there is nothing more impressive than the American non-commissioned officer. And when I couldn't get that grader onto my post, my platoon sergeant, who you see there standing, and my senior squad leader, who's in the forklift, decided, no problem, LT, we'll get this done ourselves. And what you see right there is them using a forklift to push dirt into those holes to get that done. Isn't that awesome? That is the American NCO right there. And I tell you what, that was one of the best days, most fulfilling days of my life, seeing those guys get to work. When they needed something done, they just took ownership, and very inspirational. Very inspirational to get to see these guys work hard. Okay, the next thing I needed to buy was gravel. Now, let me tell you something. Gravel is gray gold when you're building an outpost. Gravel is wonderful because, let me tell you something, when you're in a dangerous AO and you've got to call in for a medevac helicopter, that helicopter's rotor wash sends dirt everywhere. You can't see anything. And it's not only putting those helicopter pilots in danger, it's putting the soldiers in danger because of the incoming fire that they may start to take. It's putting the victim at danger because of the infections that could come because of those dirt clouds flying all over the place. So you need gravel to hold that dirt down. You need gravel so that when we're maintaining our vehicles, a giant wind doesn't come up and blow dirt all up into your engine hole. You need gravel to keep the dirt down, to keep water from stagnating, to prevent disease. Gravel was very, very important. So I went over to my little friend Popeye over there, and I asked him, what can you do for me in terms of gravel? Because every time I try and talk to an Afghan National Army officer, one of his contractors, he gives me some bogus price that I have to pay a lot of money for. What just happened here? Are we good? Did I kick something? I apologize. I'm sorry, sir. Would you mind helping me out? All right, we're good to go. Magic. All right. So I asked, hey, Papa, can you hook me up? And he said, of course. And before you knew it, I whittled that price down to $260 a truck. That's nothing. That's great. Now, here's the thing that I realized very quickly, is that if you go to Kandahar Airfield, if you went to the main post and I found out how much they paid per truck, it was closer to $500 per truck. Now, this is one thing that kind of made me think very carefully. Where do you think that money goes? Yeah, I'm getting a good price, $260 per truck. How much of that do you think is going back into some Taliban hands? I don't know. But you know what? Did I have a choice? No. Sometimes you got to get it done. Yeah, I saved the government a lot of money. I could have gone to CAF, put in a request for this operation, and maybe a month or two later, we would have had, you know, the contract filled, and they would have paid twice as much as what I did to get it done. But the cool thing that they do at the CAF finance office is they firmly vet all of their contractors. They know that not, to the best of the American government's ability, that no money is falling back into the hands of the enemy. They really, really do a good job of vetting who they give money to, much better than I could. But because of the time it was taking, it would take to get that done, and the urgency of getting this gravel laid down to build that HLZ, I mean, I said, you know what? I don't really have much of a choice. And that's kind of the factors that I had to play around with here, is I needed to build this HLZ. And I firmly accept that some of that money went back into the enemy's hands. That's kind of a hard thing for a 23-year-old lieutenant who signed for $1 million of American money to accept. But that's the reality. That's what our platoon leaders are doing every day. So we built that HLZ, and eventually went well. Sooner or later, we moved out to another strong point, and I worked with another company commander. And you know, this was a part of my daily routine. Get up, maybe eat some breakfast or some lunch with the company commander. You'll see I'm drinking some tea. I got my radio over my shoulder in case anything goes wrong, and I'm ready to react in case I need to. But for the most part, I spent a lot of time just understanding these guys and having them see my face and see me, and building that loyalty. And that went a long way in the end. That's something that I don't think we value enough in the Army even to this day. I mean, when we go through our training regimen, we do a lot of shoot, move, and communicate. But communicating with an Afghan local national is a completely different skill set. And something that is very hard to learn on the job. So this was one of the most beneficial and educational times on the tour, sitting down with this A&A company commander and getting to know his experiences. I am. There is an interpreter in the background, but I also do, just because I'm Indian, I do speak Urdu, and so actually when I needed to, I could communicate on my own. They love Bollywood, by the way. You know, they love some Indian movies, Shah Rukh Khan, they love the Indian food, Indian movies. You know, I was Amitabh Bachchan when I went over there all the time, so I was God's gift to them. Yeah, go ahead.
Maybe a good time to ask a question. I mean, speaking Urdu obviously is an advantage, but being of Indian heritage, was that a plus or a minus?
Overall? Oh, it was absolutely a plus. The question was, is being an Indian of Indian heritage a plus or minus? And it was absolutely a plus. Afghanistan and India share a very unique friendship, having a common enemy being Pakistan. Pakistan is very unpopular in both of those countries. They blame them each for a variety of different problems within their own borders. But because of the pop culture that India exports to these countries, and just generally, I think my demeanor towards them, they were very supportive, and they actually took me. You know, I was a vegetarian for about the first 6 months of my tour, and I grew up a vegetarian. I didn't start eating meat till I got very, very hungry. But when I would sit down, I always thought that when I would sit down with a meeting with a tribal elder, and you know, it's very disrespectful to refuse food. But when I refused meat, because I was, and I told them, because I'm Hindu, because I'm a vegetarian, I thought they would be like, oh, what a douchebag. You know, well, these guys can't, he can't sit with us. You know, he's disrespecting us. No, they actually loved me. They thought, wow, this is an American guy who's really embracing his culture, his ethnicity, his heritage. And it really meant the world to them. That really, that stood out to me. They value that. Yes, sir.
Rajiv, on that score, when you dealt with guys who were twice as old as you are, was that an issue at all, or didn't they get one of those, the fellow in the previous picture looked like
you? I mean, they didn't look too much older than you. How old are you, like 30, 32? yeah, that did make a difference. Age is, authority in a lot of these communities is in direct proportion to your age. And me being a 23, 24-year-old kid running around these deserts, I didn't carry a lot of weight. But to be honest, when they saw, I think you can win a lot of ground with your demeanor, with your body language, with the way you treat your subordinates. I acted like a leader. They saw that I wasn't this authoritarian, power-hungry kid. And I think that meant a lot to them. And so when I acted maturely, they treated me maturely. And that was very important.
Do they have any questions about how you got into this position as an American?
You know, funny you should say that. I had a lot of people, because of my Indian heritage, they thought I was a spy, for India, working in the Army.
Who appeared to be on a barge and only a few hundred miles away, and yet now, having been to West Point, and well, they wouldn't know that, but must have given them some.
Yeah, so the question is, did they have a idea of my background, of what got me to that area in Kandahar? And to be honest, I don't think they did. They had seen, remember, we have not been in Afghanistan 10 years, ladies and gentlemen. We have been in Afghanistan 1 year, 10 times. And what I mean by that is these folks have seen units come and units go for about 10 years. And I think by then they were just like, whatever, just the next guy in line. And they didn't really care too much about me or my background. They really did care about what I could buy for them, though. And so that was something I did have to work on. So again, here I am in that strong point. Here I'm teaching a local Afghan soldier how to jump rope, which is very hard. They're not exactly the most athletic soldiers you'll ever meet. Not that I am, but I can jump rope. Again, I made it a point to get my soldiers integrated with the Afghan National Army, make sure that they saw what they looked like, how they talked, how they, ate. And these are a lot of where that those cultural divides are going to be bridged. And, this leads to not only sharing food, but sharing in training, sharing in resources, sharing in the culture. And that's how you build a local national fighting force. So patrolling the area is very dangerous, and as you can see, this is actually a rather open road, but most of Afghanistan looks like what you see on the left there. It's pretty dense vegetation. It's hard to see, it's hard to move through, and it poses a lot of risks. IEDs are not just on the ground, they're not coming up from under you all the time. Sometimes they're coming at you from the side, from above in trees, and it poses a lot of risks for soldiers as they move about the battlefield. And so here we're pulling a TCP, a traffic control point, traffic checkpoint rather, and checking out a motorcycle that seems to be suspicious. And so the soldiers are pulling some guard. And as you can see, we have a little pet. We had a little mascot kind of follow us around. It's a little dog. We grew to love him. He's a little little flavor of home in the middle of the desert. But as you can see here, we dealt a lot with these compounds, as you can see on the right. Now these things are, man, decades if not centuries old. The walls were 3 to 4 feet thick. I mean, you could take that MGS vehicle I showed you, that 105 millimeter gun, and you could hit that compound and it would just dent it. I mean, these things are thick. You can't blow through these. And unfortunately so, you do have a lot of threats. Every one of those windows is a good fighting position. Every one of them can be used to launch an RPG, an IED. And you don't even always have to have someone back there to do it. A lot of these are victim-triggered IEDs. And so it's one of the hardest parts of the tour, one of the scariest parts of the tour, well knowing that that could happen and still having to get up every morning and walk these roads. I mean, it's heart-wrenching. Your heart beats very, very hardly underneath your body armor every time you, thank you very much, every time you leave the wire. And it's something that still affects me to this day, quite frankly. So again, whenever I got the chance to help out the Afghan National Army, I did so. Here you see me tugging their vehicle out after it got blown up. And I was just on my own mission. I was going to Ashura on the other side of the village, on the other side of the district. And we just saw these guys off to the side. We did our best to pull over and help them out. And these simple acts really win their respect and their loyalty. And so this was one of the few parts of the puzzle in which I really helped them. Now, all of that good favor that we built quickly ended when one day a fuel tanker spills off the side of the highway. And, you know, there's an Afghan company commander that goes out, the headquarters company commander goes out, tries to take control of the situation, tries to get his soldiers to leave the area. He ends up getting the civilians to leave, but that fuel is spilling. And those Afghan soldiers are saying, at least you, company commander, at least you take this fuel. This is gold here. And he says, no, you get away. And this fuel spills and those soldiers are continuing to loot it. And to take control of the situation, that Afghan officer shoots a series of rounds into that tanker. And it's one of the largest explosions and scariest moments of my life, seeing that thing go to flames and then cyclone of smoke and the smell just proliferated throughout the entire district. And that day, I don't know the exact number, but it must have been in the 15 to 20 burned alive, came through our gates that day. When my first sergeant called a mass casualty over the radio, I knew that there was going to be a flood of soldiers going towards the aid station, the medical station. And I stood there kind of speechless at what I saw, and then I thought to myself, wait a minute, like, who's calling the 9 line? So I actually ran back to the CP, and I, to be honest, I had seen what was going on. I didn't myself perform first aid. I was calling the 9 line, making sure that we got the birds in the air. And just when I announced that over the radio, there was a silence on the other line that almost indicated that they didn't believe me what happened. It was a really tragic event. And that day kind of showed us, the American force, how careless these guys were. And a lot of that trust that we had built up, not so much on their side, but our American trust for them, our ability to trust them with our lives when we leave the wire, went away. And quite frankly, I don't know if I can blame anybody for that. I see this, and even now I'm like, how did we live for a whole year with these guys? This is what our platoon leaders are dealing with day in and day out. And this is why it's so scary. It's not just the bullets and it's not just the IEDs. It's carelessness on a lot of fronts. So after that, I tried my best. Relations with the ANA were therefore strained from there on out. So I turned my attention to the local nationals and sitting down with them, trying to understand what their concerns were, what I could do to help them out. Now, one thing that when we're talking about counterinsurgency, we're essentially talking state building. We're trying to build a democracy, build a government that has legitimacy in these parts of the world. Now, the problem is that most of the legitimacy in terms of governing as a status quo rests in the arms of tribal elders. Now, those aren't politically elected officials. They're village elders. They're usually the oldest and most capable, respected leaders of the village, and they just kind of hold that title. Their word is law. Their voice is law. And so, what I'd like to do is ask you to think in terms of incentives and leverages. What incentive, if you're an Afghan tribal elder and you're in charge of all the families in your whole town, let's say you're the Lexington tribal elder, and you're in charge of everything out here in Lexington, Massachusetts, what incentive do you have to help out this 23-year-old kid who's saying, why don't you invest some more authority in the local elected government? What incentive do you have to do that when you're already the kingpin of your town? None, right? And that's exactly what we're facing here, is unless they have an incentive to do it, they're not going to do it. And they want to hold their power. They want to know that if they participate in whatever elected government that's there, that they're going to be able to control their own power, that they're going to be able to control and have their say in their own village and in their own tribe. And that's something I couldn't guarantee. And a lot of us, as even Americans, when we try and negotiate this counterinsurgency, that's something we can't guarantee, because let's face it, our presence there is, ephemeral. It's very short-lived when you think of the grand scheme of things. So one thing I'd like to also point out is what you'll see me wearing, and this is a piece of equipment that is now issued to pretty much everyone in Afghanistan, is a harness, a 5-point harness. The IED, when it blows up, under your vehicle, it tends to kick you out of the vehicle. It tends to pop shot you out. And so what that does is it actually holds me in
when the vehicle is blown up. And I only jump up maybe, you know, 3 inches off the ground. This is poppy. This is what poppy looks like when it's growing out in the field. It's a beautiful flower. Beautiful, beautiful plant. I tried to rip out a bunch of poppy and give it to my girlfriend once, and, you know, no, I'm just kidding. I didn't, but I'm sure she would have felt lovely if I had, because it is a very potent drug. Now, this is the cash crop of Kandahar and Helmand Province. This is what most of the farmers are using to get their income. Now, this is an interesting part. A while back, we tried this tactic where we would burn this. We would burn fields of poppy, because a lot of the poppy trade comes back to help out our enemies. Narcotics is one of the greatest source of black market money that that helps our enemies. There's very little that you can't learn about the Taliban that you can't learn from following organized crime, even in the United States. It is very much a mafia-style organization, and one of their cash commodities is indeed poppy. So one thing we had to do was figure out a way to kind of curb the poppy trade without affecting the local economy. And you know what? We couldn't figure it out. Because quite frankly, how do you tell a farmer not to grow poppy when that's and grow corn or cotton instead, when corn or cotton is maybe 5% as valuable? And he's got a family to feed, you know, and he's not a bad guy. He's not Taliban. He doesn't really care if his president is George Bush, Hamid Karzai. I mean, who cares? You know, he's just a local farmer in the area. And so how do you tell him not to grow in the most lucrative crop that he wants to support his family in a very poor country? That's hard. So this is what poppy looks like. It tends to dry up in the winter. And you know, as we patrol, you know, we'd see it, and there's really nothing you can do about it except for make sure that whatever's underneath that poppy isn't contraband, isn't dangerous. And so that's a pretty scary situation too, where you see a giant poppy field and you know it's a dangerous area. You want to do a search on the compound. You see this giant pile of what looks like hay. You want to go check out what's underneath it. Well, you don't know if it's booby-trapped, but you need to do the right thing. You need to search it. So another issue that we had was kids. Now, kids tend to be very rambunctious. Kids tend to be very, they can disorganize your patrol very quickly. They are not scared of you. These kids have seen so many soldiers come and go through their deserts. They come up to you, they shake your hand, they take your pens out of your pocket. They want your money, they want your attention, they want your radio, they want your cell phone. So kids were actually not scared of us. They were quite brave, actually. They, like I said, they've seen a lot of warriors come through their villages. So that was you know, one of the more interesting parts of the tour. Yes, sir.
What's the procedure for sniffing out IEDs for people on patrol?
Are you talking about, the question is, what is the procedure for sniffing out IEDs on patrol? Are you talking about? Oh, right. We have, first off, we have mine detectors that we use to with the front guy. Imagine being that front private with a mine detector in front of you. You know, what an awesome job that is. I mean, that's the reality, is we have privates on the front of the patrol, like carrying around mine detectors, trying to make sure that the rest of the patrol doesn't hit something that he can detect first. We do, there's a lot of telltale signs. It's not a completely, you know, unstudied science. It's something that we can have a grasp on. You know, miscolored dirt on the ground, just general wires that you can see. There are several markers. There are markers that they need to use so that if once we cross a certain point, that they know that's when they light it off. So there's different metrics that we use, and we got pretty good at catching them after a while. And if you patrol an area long enough and you have eyes on that road long enough, they realize that they're not going to get the chance to put one in. And so that's, you know, throughout the ends of the tour, what we ran into is if we used a road enough, they would back off. That became our territory.
Does that include night patrol?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. So one of the most valuable things that you can bring with you on patrol is your medic. Your medic is fire. Because let me tell you, I was a second lieutenant in the United States Army. And if this tribal elder is saying, hey, I need a well, I need schools, I need money, I need all these things. Yeah, I mean, I had a lot of money and I could do a lot for him. But, I mean, I can't just give it to him on the spot right there. But he has so many needs, and I'm just a second lieutenant, and he's thinking, why am I talking to this guy? I want to talk to a general. I want to talk to someone important. Call me, get Barack Obama out here. But you know what I could say to him is, hey, you know what? Do you have anyone in your village who's sick or hurt? Because I have a doctor, and he can help you. And let me tell you, if there's not anything more, there is nothing more valuable than the gift of life. And when you bring that healthcare insurance, you think it's bad here. Like, try healthcare in Afghanistan, it's really bad. And so when you bring that medic out to the front lines and have him cure one of these guys, in this case it was a dog bit him, and it was a pretty deep cut. And that's my medic, one of them, Michael Pergaro, one of the best soldiers I'd ever worked with. That's him helping put that guy back together. I tell you what, you win a lot of loyalty really quickly. So those doctors, those medics out there, they're working their butts off, and they're really making a good name for the American Army out there.
Well, why don't they have more medics out there at fewer guns?
I'm sorry, sir?
Why doesn't the U.S. Army have more medics out there at fewer guns?
The question is, why doesn't the Army have more medics and fewer infantrymen, let's say? First off, we're talking dangerous areas. I mean, you can't just throw a bunch of doctors. It's not like Doctors Without Borders can just come in and fix everybody up. We're talking about very, very dangerous areas. You need a lot of weaponry. You need people to protect them. But that is one of the longer term goals. We need to spread that ability to win hearts and minds. What that really means, spread them out, spread those medical capabilities out. And it's really up to the ground commanders to realize that that is an asset in their toolbox. And hopefully that message gets passed along. Again, here in this picture, we're just interacting with a few more kids, and hopefully building some loyalties. Speaking of medical care, what I did is I organized what's called a med cap. Basically, we took a bunch of the company's medics. I took about four medics and a whole box full of medical supplies, and I had a few villagers bring all their kids. There was about 12 kids that came out, and we just went through and gave them all checkups and. Tell you what, those families really appreciated it. It made a big difference. And yeah, it was dangerous. We put ourselves at risk. You'll see that we're not wearing helmets. I mean, this is an area that could have gotten mortared very quickly. Now, we had a cover over our heads, but we took a risk out here because we were stationary for quite a while. What you don't see is that I do have my platoon's vehicles coiled out front of this vehicle guarding us and taking care of us. But we were at risk, and that was something that we needed to do in order to show them our face, show them that we were human too. And so that was a calculated risk, and I think we did a great job. We did a good job that day. The comment was on water supply and saying how important that is to when you're trying to build up an area and how water supply can really add something to the village. So in this scene right here, I'm working with some Afghan tribal elders. Now, this guy is a very unfriendly guy. He doesn't like America. He says, get everybody. He doesn't like the Taliban either, mind you. He just wants, listen, everybody get away from my backyard. I want to run my people the way I want to run my people. So we're trying to help them out, and we're trying to get them a well. And one of the issues is everybody wants to buy a well, everyone wants to build a well, everybody wants a well in their own backyard. But the problem is, with every well that you tap, you drain that water table. And that water table gets lower and lower. And before you know it, if too many people have access to clean water, yeah, everybody's happy for about a year, and then they go bankrupt because none of their crops are able to flourish. So we had to devise a plan to get as many people fresh water as possible without draining their water table. What had ended up happening is we devised a plan. So we built one well in the center village, and I let this guy decide where that well went. This guy decided where that well went. I gave him some political authority there to make a good, prudent decision. He made the choice, and we built the well north of our outpost, Hawzi Madad. And we built that well. And they eventually had a means to transport water to the outside villages that were a little bit far away. And that was very helpful. It was a good one of the first times that I had seen a communal decision-making process happen outside of the framework of the United States Army imposing it. And so it was a good success. So I share this because it is possible. And we're making some progress, slowly but surely. Yes, sir?
How deep did you have to drill?
How deep do we have to drill for the well? Say about 100 feet. Yeah, it was pretty deep. It's not something that just, it's not like a lake is right next door or anything. It was pretty deep.
You have an engineer unit?
Actually, no. The question is, did I have an engineer unit come out to build a well? No. I actually contracted it out. Remember Popeye? It was his older brother. Yeah, I called up, I asked him, hey, how do I build a well? And his older brother, his name was Ahmed Shah, was his name. And I tell you what, he actually was even a bigger help throughout the tour than Popeye was. It's really mean that I'm calling him Popeye. He was actually a really good guy. That was just his nickname that we had for him. But Ahmed Shah built that well for me. So I not only was able to build a well, and I did this several times. We didn't only just build wells in important parts of the area that needed it, but we were able to inject money into the economy. Now, again, how much of that money did Ahmed Shah have to pay off to the enemy so that he could operate freely and safely? I don't know. But you know what? Stuff needed to happen, and I just made it happen. And that was a risk that we had to undertake. And you know, to this day, I know that there are people that say that I did the wrong thing, absolutely. But when you're a platoon leader in a really bad area and you're trying to fight a counterinsurgency, you know, I'm the guy with the money. And so I made the decision. And then we played Simon Says with the kids, as you can say. This is one of my squad leaders, Sergeant McMillan. Really good at interacting with the locals, and as you can see, he had a good time playing around with those locals. This is him again in the dense vegetation of the Argandab. It is very hot. I'm not sure if you can really tell, but it is about 120 degrees out there. It is nuts. Am I talking okay in the microphone? I hear some feedback. Is it okay? So it's about 120 degrees. He's wearing probably about 80 pounds of gear. And he looks like RoboCop, so he's not exactly going to be the friendliest guy out there on the battlefield when it comes to interacting with a local tribal elder, or even local kids for that matter. So it's interesting to see how we go from kind of this RoboCop looking guy to someone very human and fun, like in this picture right here. And it was a process that took some time, but it took us getting comfortable in that heavyweight, in that, you know, incredible heat. It took a lot of time, but we got there after the course of a year. This is us, me and my platoon, a few of my soldiers. You know, they are everything to me. These guys did so much for me. They saved my life numerous times. They took good care of me, and they are some of the most amazing Americans that you'll ever meet. And each one of them, if they want it, has a great career in the Army. So I'm very proud to have served with them. Christmas time in Afghanistan was fun. We had some care packages I delivered out. This guy is Doug Hoffman. Doug is actually a guy from my hometown near Roanoke, Virginia. And he and I took a special liking to each other. He was a good man. And, you know, tried to celebrate the holidays in style as much as we could. And before you know it, our outpost looked like this. You know, what I once saw, when I once showed you, that big, giant, wet hole in the ground. We eventually, with a lot of help, once the 101st Airborne Division came to replace us, their 2nd Brigade came to replace us out of Kandahar. They had brought with them a lot of engineer resources and a lot of equipment. And before you know it, this was a little mini America. It was a little city. I mean, I look back and I just cannot believe that happened in a year. The American Army can move pretty fast. It seems slow when you're getting shot at and blown up sometimes, but in the long run, that happened really fast. Just some scenery from an area called Cochriz. Cochriz is where I was for the elections in August of 2009. It was the presidential elections where Dr. Abdullah was rumored to have had some degree of competition with Ahmed Karzai, but the vote was largely rumored to be rigged and corrupt. And so we were out there, and I tell you what, these scenes, it is an absolutely gorgeous country. When you can get by the chaos, it is absolutely a gorgeous country. I'm going to finish up here with some conclusions, and then we'll move on. The first thing I want to tell you guys is for our platoon leaders, they need to watch and control the money. Money is what gets things done out there. And yeah, we got, like I said, just because you have the biggest guns doesn't mean that you have the most power. And so our platoon leaders, you can watch and control the money, not just control it in terms of buying and contracting and you know, giving out money for tips and stuff like that, but watching the incentives that those Afghan National Army officers have on those outposts. Avoid cookie cutter approaches. You know, one thing that we do in the Army is we always memorize battle drills, battle drill 1 alpha, battle drill 6, and we try and apply these cookie cutter approaches to unique landscapes, unique situations on the battlefield. And you know, that's not how you win or fight a war. Our soldiers and our officers are smart people. And what we need to do is empower them to make unique decisions, unique, original solutions for the unique and original problems that they face on every single battlefield every day. And that's the kind of problem-solving mentality that I believe we need to foster in the next generation of military leaders. Training shortcomings. Like I said before, we don't train very much on how to interact with a tribal elder. It may be a day or two in your entire year of pre-deployment training. We do, you know, kinetic training from the squad, platoon, live fire, company, battalion, brigade, XEVALs, and NTC or JRTC rotation. But when it comes to learning how to contract a well or learning how to build a school or build a road. I mean, I had to figure that out in theater. The proper way to use money, the proper way to interact and build a safer area in Afghanistan. I had to learn that on the ground when the bullets were already flying at me. And that's something that I think we need to bring to the pre-deployment process. I think our NTC and JRTC stations are actually doing a pretty good job of it, to be honest. I learned a lot about that when I was in those rotations, but it needs to start earlier. When you know you're right and your moral compass, these are two things that I think go hand in hand, and that is, you know, sometimes you are on the ground and you want to see something happen and you need something to happen, and guys behind you, guys above you, they're saying, no, not going to happen. But you know what? If I saw something that was wrong or if I saw something that needed to be done, I had the fortitude to say, I'm going to do it because it's about my boys. It's about my soldiers. And you know, I'm not going to lie. Did I put my career at risk? Yeah, I did. But you know, it's you play for keeps out there. And I think it's really cool that even today, when I look at West Point, when I go out and I interact with those cadets, they're very strong-willed people, and they know why they're in the Army. They know why they're serving. And they make their decisions for the right reasons. So I really encourage us to continue to trust our junior leaders. Any other questions, please? Yes, sir.
Yeah, in the 16-month tour of Vietnam, I never saw anybody from the press the whole time I was there. And I was in the field for quite a while, and then at the Fort Observer, and then back. And the feeling we get now from here watching the Middle East is that there's a journalist embedded all over. Did you run into the press over there at all?
The question is, did I have any journalists embedded with me? And yes, I did. Quite a few times, actually. I had Anand Gopal from the Wall Street Journal. I had Sebastian Abbott from the Associated Press, Rajiv Chandrasekharan from the Washington Post. I had a few, especially in Kandahar and Helmand, which is kind of where we're making our money right now, where a lot of the focus is. Yeah, the press is everywhere, and it's good. They're telling the story. The question that I pose is not so much are the press there, but what is the relationship between the media and the military? That's something that I always question in a unit, because right now, I think in some units it's very good, but I've seen it also be very bad. And the result is that a bad story is written about us. And that's not the best way to interact with the military. Any other questions, please? Yes, sir.
You referred to, at one time, you referred to the area you're in the desert. But in some of the pictures, there's lush greenery.
Yeah.
Other pictures are desert. Could you describe the terrain?
Yeah, that's a great point. The question is, you know, I keep on saying there's a desert there, but there's also lush greenery, and that's absolutely right. So remember that highway that I mentioned? So south of that highway was pretty lush vegetation, and we operated south. The Taliban were in the south. The enemy was in the south. But like I said, that water table was drained because of all the wells that were tapped in the south. The north of that highway was largely desert. And that was not arable land. Yes, sir.
How about that transition? You left to...
Absolutely. So the transition from... Okay, first I'll go through the transition for when I came into Afghanistan. And the truth is that we didn't really have much of a transition. We were the first striker unit to come onto underground in Kandahar. And when we were in Zari, we were the first American unit there. There were no Canadians there when I showed up. So we kind of had to make it up as we went along. Now, when we had it's funny. I think and I talked to a lot of my peers, and the internal climates within units these days is the worst. You know, the worst unit in the Army is the one that you're replacing, and the only unit that's better than the one that's ahead of them is the unit that's replacing you. You know, everybody wants to come into Afghanistan and win the war in a year. You know, and I think that's you're right. The transitions are not really well defined. I think. We do not do a good job of communicating to our units when they're coming in or leaving where their role begins and where our role ends. You can't win this war in a year, and you're absolutely right. I think those transitions do need work. And we need to show a little bit more respect to those who are, if we were unsuccessful in some areas, rather than simply saying, oh, those guys didn't patrol enough, they didn't do enough, you know, take the time to understand and appreciate the challenges that each of those units faced. And I think culturally, it's good. We breed a culture of confidence and machismo, and I think that's good to a lot, to some degree. We need confident soldiers, but we don't need those who are arrogant and who can't learn from those who have been there.
Why are we there? I know you're a military person. Why are we there? You come in. That group goes, and you go. You're talking about these people that are situated where they're running the tribal community. They're not going to change. They're there unless they get killed. So what is the purpose? Just to come in and spend money and sound like we're doing well? What change?
I mean, sir, that's something we're, you know, that's something that is more of a, it's definitely out of my league. But I do share your concern. I think this is not an area, especially in Pakistan, ladies and gentlemen, I'd argue is an area of concern. This part of the world, not just Afghanistan, screw the borders. Let's talk about South Asia as a whole. This is an area that is very vulnerable to some extremist tendencies. And so how the method that we engage this concept is one thing, but I mean, I can vouch for the fact that it is a part of the world that does need attention in terms of our national security strategy. Yes, sir.
Do you have any thoughts you'd like to share with us about the final days of Bin Laden?
I tell you what, I live in New York City. I live in Harlem. Yeah, people say I went from Afghanistan to Harlem. It's like, don't I want a day off, right? But you know, when I walked out of New York City on Monday morning and Bin Laden had been killed the night before, there were like people going crazy in those streets. And in Times Square, people were drinking all night long and going, we won, we won, we got him, we got him. I tell you what, I felt, to be honest, a degree of anger because I felt we had, you know, the Army has been in war for 10 years and I felt that a large degree of Americans weren't really with us, really empathizing with us, really feeling what the strain of war is. When I see families being broken by it, I see soldiers, young kids with 4 or 5 deployments under their belt, and I see that I felt like the killing of Bin Laden was kind of hijacked by a society that has not adequately helped us fight this war, to be honest. And maybe that's arrogant of me to say, but I just know that I have a lot of my soldiers, a lot of my boys that have given so much, and I see that not getting as much attention as it deserves, in my opinion at least. And so I'd offer you that the killing of Bin Laden is not much more than a symbolic victory. We got him, but the war goes on. We still have over 140,000 soldiers still in harm's way, and I urge you to keep the celebrations modest. And you'll notice people in uniform, in my opinion, have been rather measured in their response. It's a good thing we killed them, but got a long ways to go. This is my contact info. I am vicious with email, and I'm vicious with my cell phone. So if there's anything I can ever do for you, as veterans, as folks in this brotherhood of people who've served this country, both families and soldiers themselves, please let me know. And with that, I thank you very much for inviting me today. I wish you all the best.